deployees of the ANC, and I would like to believe that they are disciplined members of the ANC. I personally, if we were to talk about conscience, my political conscience was built by the ANC itself. And if we talk about conscience, the ANC is a mass movement. You've got religious people, you've got traditional people. Surely if we're going to move according to religious conscience as individuals, then it means the ANC no more exists. When we talk about conscience, we talk about conscience as an ANC member. So I would agree with Comrade Tavan that it's a non-issue. The opposition wants to destroy the ANC, and they say that. They don't want to help the ANC. They want to destroy it. And how do you vote together with those people who openly say they want to destroy the ANC? So it's a non-issue. It's clear how our vote as ANC MPs is going to be. Thank you.
Last round of questions. Take all the hands that are 1, 2, 3, 4. Maybe five. Just before question, let's take an
addition. Let me wait on the coming.
Yeah. Thank you.
I was saying that you will recall that this steering committee is mandated by the National Council to engage with the national leadership of the ANC and the MKMVA. Now, what guide us in terms of that engagement is contained in the resolutions that was taken at the December council meeting. You'll recall that there was a time when we were delayed with the release of those resolutions, and our reason, as we ultimately informed you, was that we first had to inform the ANC leadership and MKMVA about the resolutions before they become public. We did that. And you will recall further that when we're doing that, there was some disruption at that press conference. A disruption which some of your colleagues that were there openly ask questions as to whether is this genuine or is it a staged disruption. And the answer you were given to that question was that if you just judge for yourself, we just see it the way you see it. Later on after that, we were told that the disruptor want to come and apologize and to us. And we said that no, let the disruptor go and apologize to the media because he did this to the media. The MKMVA leadership further promised that disciplinary measures are going to be taken against the disruptor. To date,
we are still waiting to hear. Each time we ask them, that has not yet been done. And part of some of the resolutions that were taken at the December conference were this, that we are deeply disturbed that the association has become involved in factionalism and sought to style itself as the political voice of Umkhonto weSizwe community, distorting both the values and history of MK. And before you, in that press briefing, the National Council and MKVA pledged to work together. You have seen a continuous display and abuse of people in tropical camouflage uniform marching there, calling themselves MK. And some of you have already mentioned that the ages of those people is doubtful whether those people are MK. This is despite the pledge that we, together with MKMVA, made before you. And the ANC is in crisis. And the December Council resolved that. As MK, we are not going to be part and parcel of any faction that is going to be showing up during this crisis, including announcing individual preferences about the many tendencies, some of which, most of them are contradicting one another, that are developing. Because when you do so, you are further deepening the divisions. Hence, the call for a national consultative forum. But we continue to see pronouncement made on this crisis and contradictions made in the name of Umkhonto weSizwe by the MKMVA. You will recall the issue of bribe mulefe. It was said that MK endorsed that problem that was around bribe mulefe. It was not true. Recently, after the controversial cabinet reshuffle, it was said MK endorses the reshuffle. It is not true. The people that were abused with tropical camouflage uniform there are said to be MK, and they are declared by MK. It is not true. MK cannot be part and parcel of this crisis that are showing up within the Sikh African National Congress. As even in terms of our resolution in December, we have said that, further believing that throughout the history of our movement, particularly in time of crisis, MK has contributed to finding solutions. And not to begin to pronounce this position as against that position, this position. If you had carefully what all the comrades here have been saying, when you ask them question about the trends, they are expressing a personal opinion. They're not saying MK. And this is how, as the National Council, we are saying. Obviously, as an individual, you'll have a position. But this is the temptation of factionalizing further, being seen to be belonging to that faction as against that faction. But clearly, We are so worried about the current situation within the country and in particular in the ANC that we do have positions. But those positions are those of an individual. This is how this thing is supposed to be. The National Consultative Forum, after the ANC has properly diagnosed itself what kind of medication it needs, not the symptoms that we see, will arrive at a situation where ANC can heal itself and be able to begin to debate as to what is the way forward out of the crisis. So our problem, our current challenges with the MP and VA is a violation of, there has been the deadlock. We are told how the deadlock arises. But throughout their conduct, ever since we appeared before you, they are not honoring what they promised themselves to do. Thank you.
Final opportunity for questions. We'll take the minutes that is up with the panel.
That is for outside this conference, press conference. Okay.
From Eyewitness News, you said as a steering committee, you knew that this would be an uphill and there would be resistance to your calls, and that you know exactly where this resistance is coming from, because there are those who are benefiting from wrongdoing in the party. Could you name names of who is benefiting and where this resistance is coming from, seeing as you say you know exactly where it's coming from?
You know, there's a concern in the country about this, you know, this determining of progress. So let's say we have corrupted the president, you know, they are now influencing, you know, critical decisions in the government of South Africa. What is your take on this? But there are even calls that the destination should be announced.
So if I have an opportunity to sort of close the conference now, on the left side.
So how would you respond to critics that say that the ANC, both its like members and its supporters, are prioritizing the survival of the party and the continued dominance of the party over the good of South Africa?
Sorry, it's Claudia again. I'm so sorry that I didn't ask this earlier. You said earlier when you spoke about protests and the MK guys protecting Liberty House, that you've always supported the voice of the masses and that you won't protect something against the will of the people. Would you then support the growing mass action in terms of the citizens of South Africa protesting in thousands, in tens of thousands, as we've seen last week and this week, in calling for President Jacob Zuma to go there?
Thank you very much. Thank you very much to the panel.
Well, I'll leave the new wave of interest to my colleagues to respond to. I was coming before these microphones thinking that we're dealing with the last question of this press conference, the point that was raised about the canning of the policy conference. Just to say that, our logic is this. As an organization, as a party, we are not in trouble because of being found wanting as far as sector policies in government are concerned, which is primarily what the policy conference is intended to address. An evaluation of performance and the appropriateness of our different sector policies. That's not what is making the ANC wobble. What is making the ANC wobble is the state of the organization itself, its political positioning, which is generating a lot of disaffection within the traditional support base of the ANC. And this is what we say must be a priority. That is why we say the policy conference can always come after. And matter of fact, just to remind, you know, ourselves where we are coming from with this policy conference. At the beginning, we did not have policy conferences. Policy conferences were only introduced as a measure to assist the organization do sufficient work in terms of creating space for enough discussion of policy issues, which the opinion that was emerging was that national conferences no longer provide the necessary space that we need, because focus becomes focus is placed on the election of new leadership at national conference. So it was just a measure. There's no principle about it. It is just a managerial provision to make the organization function better. So if we agree that what is critical at this point are the political challenges around the ANC, we can even agree to deal with the sector policy issues at the national conference, the way we've always done that. I mean, the way we used to do it in the past, it would not, as far as we are concerned, be much of a challenge, because the challenge now is to keep the organization together, to hold the organization, the institution, from fragmenting. Everything else will follow. That's the point that I wanted to respond to. Whether we can name the people who are responsible for wrongdoing within the ANC, that question, as you can tell, is very mischievous. We are about saving the organization. The ANC has an integrity committee which has been put in place precisely to address challenges of this nature. Every and any information at our disposal, we know where to take it to the integrity committee for it to be assessed. We can't table it here at the press conference if we are really about saving the organization. Can I leave the other questions to my colleagues? General, can you come back to us?
I missed Ranjani's question, really, but I don't know, but those who got the question, was
please. I can ask you. Okay. The first question I asked you was how you, if there are any measures you are considering, whether legal or otherwise, to protect the image of a reputation of MK and to stop it being denigrated by the tropical plant camouflage people. And then I asked you about the conflation of the ANC, the entire ANC with the president, in that people are saying that they need to protect the president in order to protect the ANC. Whether you agree with that summation, and thirdly, I
asked you about Pastor Gordon. Okay, we are following this deadlock. We are going to convene council again, at which meeting we are going to discuss the issue of what we do about this continued belligerence or failure on the part of MKMVA leadership to do the right thing, because our council spoke against any public display of uniform or any regalia that looks military. We're going to discuss those things, whether we can't be, or even going to discuss what we are going to be doing to respond to this deadlock. And I don't want to say what we will be suggesting, or to even to guess, second guess conference, what it will be suggesting will be our next move. And also, we're also still going to engage with the ANC to find out if they can't help to break this deadlock. Of course, the president of the ANC is the head of the organization. But like many people would be worried about the impact of the president on the party's fortunes in the future. So at any gatherings of the African National Congress that we seek, we'll have to look at these questions. Because in the end, our allegiance is to the country and through the ANC to the country. So our allegiance is to the country and then to the African National Congress.
Congress.
We joined the ANC not because we thought the ANC, because we thought the ANC is the best instrument for us to advance our national liberation. With the emphasis on national liberation, the country. So for us, it's country first. Now, Praveen, I personally worked with Praveen and, internally, and obviously can vouch for him. But you know, many of these things that happen, especially at such critical junctures in our politics, it happened before the transition. Polokwane, there were many reports, intelligence. It happened even during Mandela's time, where peddlers, it's not intelligence reports, political intelligence peddling takes place. And some of them we don't even know about. Some of them you don't know about. But people peddling, and we hear about them. And some of you may hear about them that we don't know about. Of certain decisions that are taken because people have been given certain intelligence reports, so-called. So this intelligence report, from what we hear, has not been taken into account to serious consideration by the ANC, has been repudiated by everybody. So and we hear, of course, that some people from the other sections of the ANC or factions in the ANC would try to label people because people stand in certain positions in relation to their own interests as spies. It's not new. And even this thing that Comrade Len was talking about, of the intervention when we had a press conference with the veterans, all those things are attempts to impugn the integrity of people. So I also don't believe, and I think many people don't believe, that in that so-called intelligence report. There's a question that was asked. Okay, I've answered the City Press question in relation prioritizing the party, and I'll attempt to answer it again. You know, we believe why we are doing everything through the African National Congress. First of all, it's because it's our organization historically, and secondly, it's because we don't believe that all is lost. As Comrade Thabang said, some people think that it's a lost cause. The ANC is a lost cause, and that it will never recover. But we are here because we think that we can give it that lease of life. And the reason why we prioritize the party is because in the party, historically, the party has fought for the liberation of South Africa, and we've always regarded the party as a leader of society, and we always wanted the party to have hegemony, to lead the country in terms of ideas, in terms of morality, and so on, given its history, and also given its objectives. Because we believe that the ANC's objectives of creating a democratic, non-racial, non-sexist South Africa, you know, are still achievable by that organization. We believe that the ANC is actually the only party with a history and leadership that can steer the country in that direction. And this leadership, a lot of it is on the sidelines at the present. Hence, we are mobilizing that leadership to come back to the African National Congress in order to steer the party in that direction. Because we think that the country would be better served by an ANC, but not the ANC which in its current form. The ANC which we want to reorganize and to reflect upon in a national consultative conference that we are calling for, in order that the ANC can become the ANC of the future, which we believe it can. So it's not as if we are putting the country, we are putting the ANC first because we think the ANC is the vehicle that can be used by the country in order to advance its general interests. But we know that the ANC at this present juncture is veering from its historical vision and would like to put it back. I don't know if somebody can answer about the Guptas.
Sorry.
Answer about families, answer about organization.
Maybe from the onset, let me start by saying I'm not the spokesperson of the Guptas. Neither am I a promoter of the Guptas. Nor have I studied Guptaism. I haven't. But I think the key thing for me, it's simple. I wanted to deal first, in addition to what General Nyanda said regarding Comrade Pravin Gordhan. I concur with him. The answer is a big no. He's not a spy. He's never been. Like all of us seated here, he had an opportunity to be recruited into the enemy ranks during difficult times. Anyone who's arrested today in the country, he's not tortured like we're tortured. He's not put under detention without trial, like all of us who have been. And during which period they recruit you, they offer you all sorts of good life, the Hollywoods of some kind and so forth and so on. We resisted all that. Precisely because we believe in the justness of the cause that was championed by the ANC. So to start now and begin to label people that sees wrong that are happening in the organization, that's a culture of intolerance. This is not what we fought for. We fought to defend your right to be heard. And you had the responsibility to convince me in order to understand or to interpret what you are saying is the correct thing. This culture that is starting now of booing individuals that are raising issues that are wrong within the organization, it's an ANC. The booing that he has been subjected to, together with the Treasurer General of the ANC, last week, total an ANC, unheard of in this organization. But this tendency has been growing. At some point, he was accused that how can he become a Minister of Finance, yet he owns shares in the banks. Most banks' shares are open there in the public to be owned. Anyone can buy shares. I do buy shares if I have money, and therefore can't be regarded as the owner of the bank. And a number of these comrades, and including yourselves, you are allowed to buy shares to publicly listed companies. So then later, if you differ with me, then I'm to use that as the owner of the banks. It doesn't make sense. It will never make sense. So I think we have a responsibility as disciplined members to begin to dissuade this emerging tendency of when you differ with somebody and you begin to label that particular individual. It's not right. And I'm saying, I dare declare that anyone who says that is ANC must come publicly. To woo a person that you do not necessarily agree with is totally an ANC. And there's also this new tendency of saying if you oppose or you raise certain things that you don't agree with, you must raise it within the structures of the ANC. Why do you raise them publicly? In the very same structures. When you raise this issue, there are these deafening voices that are coming up to say, no, no, sit down, that's totally an ANC. We don't need those things. Now coming to the issues of the families, yeah, indeed, they appear to be quite powerful. To an extent that you find even members of MKMVN defending them. That our own comrades could not assist us, this family assisted us. Where do they come from? How do they amass the wealth that they have at the moment? There are a number of questions that can be asked about them. But we are not here to glorify and give them unnecessary publicity that they don't deserve. Those that were best placed to speak on their behalf, they will do so. We can speak on behalf of the community of former Umkhonto we Sizwe members, genuine. That much we can speak volume about. We can speak from the morning until sunset and won't get tired. But these ones, please do understand, none of the comrades that are seated here represent interests within that family. Our interests are well represented within the organization that we're trying to assist. Thanks.
Maybe just to add on this question of why MK is saying to be clinging to the ANC, even if it sees the ANC is doing wrong things, or is in the crisis that it is in. We are who we are and what we are because of the African National Congress. Part of our DNA now is the African National Congress. And as members of Umkhonto we Sizwe, we have a pledge which says we will remain soldiers of the South African Revolution. It's not saying soldiers of the African National Congress. Our pledge says we will remain soldiers of the South African Revolution in the service of the people. This pledge is not saying in the service of members of the African National Congress. It says in the service of the people of South Africa. Meaning the ANC and its allies. With discipline, dedication, and dedication at all times. This is what makes the National Council to be so much worried about what is happening in the country now. Our pledge, we have pledged to
put our lives on the line for the people of South Africa. Fortunately, some of us survived, but there are those who perished. And those people who perished, they perished being given a choice to say, tell us what guy is, tell us what he's doing. And they said, you rather hang me. And they were hanged, not disclosing even a bullet, where a bullet was hidden. We survived, we are still here because those people decided to give their lives, to save our lives. For what? Not to protect corruption in the ANC. Not to blindly defend what is wrong. As God says, we are members of the African National Congress, not members of leadership of the African National Congress. What is African National Congress? Is it the leadership? No. The African National Congress is an embodiment of all the values and principles of the ANC, including its glorious tradition. Now, anybody who deviates from that, we will have to engage with that person seriously. Simply because, as I say, we have pledged. Our pledge is about the people of South Africa. There was a question of what is happening about this mass protest about the governance under the ANC. These are part and parcel of the people of South Africa. They are speaking. We would wish the African National Congress leadership to engage these people and hear them out, and not to condemn them or to distance themselves from them. We know what happened to the apartheid government when it refused. So we cannot, we know the ANC to be its principles and values. I can call myself a member of the ANC and behave in a manner that is contrary to those values and principles and the tradition. I can be in the leadership of the ANC. So MK is not going to allow a situation where somebody who, or a group of people who engages, displays, and talk contrary to the principles and values of the ANC to own the ANC. You know, they say in an economic system, good money is driven by bad money out of circulation. Bad money drives good money out of circulation. We know that we had a crooked rand, pure 1 ounce of gold. That was good money, not this token that we have now. But where it is no longer out of circulation, it's out. We are left with this almost valueless tokens. Now, how can we allow the brand ANC or distance ourselves from the brand we know, the brand that we are product of, the ANC that has made us who we are? How can we allow this brand to be taken over by people who in their behavior and conduct are not in terms of what we know the values and principles of the ANC is. I've said those comrades who laid their lives and saved our lives, they did so for us to save and preserve the values and principles of the African National Congress. We are not defending individuals. We are defending the values and principles of the African National Congress. Thank you.
Thank you. I think on that note, we have many angles.